So, good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
So I'm very thankful for the opportunity that is given to me to share the word to you today. Because actually, last Monday, just want to tell some stories about myself first before I move on to the preaching. So last Monday, actually, I strained my back. So it was so painful that I was not able to move. It was so difficult for me to move, so I was confined in the house, so resting. So I'm so thankful that I'm here right now, standing, having the opportunity to share, to be sharing the word to you today. Because God is so powerful. I'm so thankful for His grace. I'm so thankful for His strength, and I'm so thankful that God is our healer. So today we will be starting a new series entitled Encounter. So these are the stories of the people who had a powerful encounter with God. Because of that, they were radically changed by that encounter. And as a result, they also helped other people encounter God as well. So, so I think if I would ask, right now, how many among us here wants to have an encounter with God? I think, yeah, immediately people are raising their hands, because I think all of us, if not most of us, wants to have an encounter with God. We want to know Him, we want to experience Him, right? And I believe that that is not what we just want for ourselves, but I believe that that is also what we want for other people, especially those people that are close to us. We want them to experience God, encounter God as well, right? So, my second question to you right now is this. How many among us here wants to be an instrument of God? Okay. So, some of you will raise your hand, but some of you is quite hesitant to raise your hand. Because maybe there are some thoughts, maybe there are some questions in your mind that is running in your mind. So, sometimes there are questions and there are thoughts in our minds that somehow hinders us to do that, that hinders us to share the word to other people, right? And some of the thoughts, the question that we might have in our mind is this, they will not believe me. If I will share the gospel to that person will not believe me. They will not take me seriously. Or sometimes the questions that we have in mind is that, why me? Why should I be the one to share the gospel to that person if I'm just an ordinary person? Why me? Why should I? Or why should I share the gospel to that person? Because that person is the one who hurt me the most, and then I'll be sharing the word to that person. Why should I? So sometimes those questions, those thoughts hinders us from sharing the word, right? So today, like what I've said, we will be talking about people who have encountered with God, people who also have the same questions and who also have the same thoughts in their minds. And as we look into their lives, our goal is to be able to learn how they overcome that those thoughts or those questions in their mind. So today we will talk about a person who said, "They will not believe me." So can you guess the person who said that? This is also a bit good, and it's also written in our bulletin that Moses said that they will not believe me. Okay, so today we will look into his life, and we will look into how we will look into the first time he encountered God. Okay, so in Exodus chapter 3, verse 1-8. So our main text is found in Exodus chapter 1, chapter 3, verse 1-8. And after that, we will look into some verses in chapter 4. And then we will jump back to chapter 1 and chapter 2. So by around 6 p.m., we'll be finished. So is that okay? Okay, no, just kidding. I will try my best to just finish at 4:30 p.m. So, can we just stand first and just let's read the word. Let's read the word. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "Now Moses was speaking of God, his father, Jethro,
the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness, and he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside the great size, for the bush was not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called him out of the bush. Moses, Moses, and he said, here I am. Then he said, do not come near, take your sandals off your feet, for the place which you are standing in is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their circumstances. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey.
So let's pray. Lord, we just want to thank you, God, for this word. God, thank you, Lord, that your word is living and active, God. And Lord, we thank you because your word will not return void and empty, God, but it will accomplish the very reason for which it was sent. Lord, we just pray, God, we just want to lift up this time to you. Lord, we pray for your guidance, for your leading. And Lord, I pray, God, that as I speak your word, I pray, God, that I will not speak out of my own understanding, God, but I will speak out of the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that you will be the one to open up our minds and our hearts to receive your word. We lift up this time to you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So you can take your seats. So let's look at Moses' encounter with God. Okay. So here we can say that Moses' encounter with God can be considered as it's perfect in timing. Why? We consider the encounter of Moses with God as perfect in timing because they said that Moses' life can be divided into 40 years. Okay. The first 40 years of his life, he lived it as a prince in Egypt. Then the second 40 years of his life, he lived it as a shepherd. Okay. So during this time of encounter, Moses was already finished with the second 40 years of his life. So he was already transitioning to another stage of his life. That's why we can consider that the encounter was perfect in timing. So aside from that, we can also consider that the encounter of Moses is it's clear. His encounter with God was very clear because when Moses encountered God, it was in the wilderness. It was in the wilderness. It is in a place of isolation. Okay. So like for us, most of the time, we encounter God or we hear from God during the time when we are just alone. Or most of the time, we hear God at the lowest point of our life. So during this time, Moses was alone. It was also the lowest point of his life. And I believe that God really caught his full attention because he was in the wilderness and God met him. Okay. So the second third is that aside from being perfect in timing, clear, we can consider that the encounter was powerful because God did not just show himself to Moses through the fire, but he caused Moses to hear him audibly. He allowed Moses to hear his voice audibly. In fact, God even called him twice, Moses, Moses. So it was a very powerful encounter. Aside from that, we can also consider that it was a sacred moment. It was a sacred moment. That's why God told Moses, take off your sandals, because this is a holy ground. Because where the presence of God is, then there's a sacred moment because God is there. And then, last is, we can consider that Moses' encounter with God was a defining moment. It was a defining moment, not just for him, but for the whole nation of Israel. Because God is already, starting to unfold His plans for Moses and His plans for the nation of Israel. So, that is Moses' encounter with God. We can see how amazing it is, right? The encounter. And I remember the time when before I entered into full-time ministry, people will ask me, have you considered to going to a full-time ministry or becoming a missionary? So most of the time, I will tell them, I will go into full-time ministry, or I will just consider that if I have a burning bush experience. So because I know the seriousness of going into a full-time ministry, so I really want to be sure that this is really coming from God. That's why I always tell them that I will only consider that if I will have a burning bush experience. But true enough, I had something like that. Not actually a burning bush experience, but I had something like that. It was very clear. It was perfect in timing. So for me, that is how I view Moses' encounter with God. This was powerful, it was perfect in timing, it was clear. So now, after looking at the encounter of Moses with God, now let's look at his response. So what is Moses' response after he encountered God? So we can say that Moses is one of the greatest leaders of all time. Right? Just imagine leading around 600,000 men, excluding women and children. And aside from that, the Ten Commandments was established through Moses. Right? The tabernacle was also established through Moses. And before he rose to leadership, he had an encounter with God. So now let's look at his encounter with God. So as we look at his encounter, our goal and our heart is not to put him down or anything, because like what I said, Moses is a very we can consider Moses as a great leader. He is a great leader. So as we look at his encounter, my heart is not to put him down, but to learn from his response. Okay. So having said that, let's move on. So after God introduced himself and after God gave his instructions to Moses, this was Moses' response. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 11, it says here, but Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? Moses responded by saying, who am I? It seems that Moses was telling God, I am just a shepherd. So I am just a shepherd. I am poor. I am one of the poorest of the poor. And I am ceremonially unclean, and nobody wants to associate with me. Sorry, I'll just get some tissue. So that is what Moses was trying to tell God. Who am I? God, I'm just a shepherd. I'm just the poorest of the poor. I'm just an outcast. Nobody wants to associate with me. Because during that time, that is how people look at a shepherd. And aside from that, maybe Moses was also telling God, are you sure I'm a convict. I just killed somebody 40 years ago. And then you are calling me to go to Pharaoh, one of the most powerful person in the world. And he is even considered to be a God. Then you want me to go to him and speak to him. So God, Moses telling God, who am I? Why should I do that? Moses responded that way because he is looking at his position. Moses was looking at his position. So most of the time, when God called us to do something, we also respond the same way. Like for example, if God will tell us, you need to share the gospel to that person. Maybe if you are, like for example, if you are just as young as Daniel, or as young as John, right? Maybe your response would be, why should I share the gospel? I'm just a child. I'm just a son, or I'm just a daughter. If God will tell us, you know, you need to confront your boss with the truth, maybe our response will be, God, I'm just an employee, and you are asking me to confront my boss with the truth. Sometimes that is also how we respond to God. Okay. So, but this is how God responded to Moses. God said, he said, but I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. So he said, I will be with you. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. So God said, I am who I am. So here we can see the contrast. So Moses was looking at himself, but God was redirecting him towards him. It seems that God was telling Moses, Moses, you are asking the wrong question. You should be, instead of asking me, who are you? You should be asking, who am I? Okay? Because instead of, maybe God is telling Moses, instead of asking me to show who are you, you should be asking me to show the great I am. Right? Because this church, it's not about us. First and foremost, it's not about our position. It's not about us. It's about God. Remember that. It's not about our position. It's about God. It's not about us. It's about Him. It's about His purpose. It's about His plans. And second, let's look at Moses' response. It says in Exodus chapter 4, verse 1, then Moses answered, but behold, they will not believe me or listen to my voice, for they will say, the Lord did not appear to you. So here Moses said, they will not believe me or listen to my voice. So here, the reason why Moses said this is because first, Moses was overwhelmed by the task that was given to him, by the responsibility that was given to him. So just imagine, like what I said a while ago, Moses was given a task to lead 600,000 men. And aside from the women and the children. So then considering the people that they are leading, the character, the attitude of the people they are leading, I think most of us are familiar with the stories. We know how those people grumble against Moses. Right? And aside from that, let's also put into consideration the armies that they are going against with. During the time, the Egyptian is one of the most powerful nation. So just imagine the task that Moses is taking on. So it was so great of a responsibility. So aside from that, during that time, the Israelites was already enslaved for about 430 years. So they've been living in that nation, and they've been experiencing the same thing for the past 430 years. So maybe they are already used to it. So they are already used to the slavery, the treatment that they are receiving. So that's why most of the Bible commentaries will tell us that Moses felt that if he will say that to the people or to the Israelites, they will not believe him because it's so great, so amazing, and people have been living in that situation for quite a long time. So that's why he was asking for signs and wonders. So Moses was responding by asking for a proof. Moses responded by asking for a proof. So sometimes it is also the same thing with us. Sometimes because of the greatness of the things that God wants us to do to somebody, or the greatness of God's plan to that person, sometimes when God asks us to do that, or to say that to other person, sometimes our response is also, God, He will not believe me if I will say that. Right? Like for example, I'll give you an example about salvation. Right? Salvation, we know how great it is. Right? Just being with God, living in heaven, and a place just full of gold and all of those things, and just being able to spend the rest of our lives with God. It's so great, right? But sometimes when God asks us to say that, to share that to other people, sometimes our response is that, God, maybe they will not believe me. Yeah. So maybe they will not believe me. Or sometimes, like another example is this. Like for example, in terms of healing, we know that God's heart for each and every one of us is to heal. That's why God said in His word, by His wounds and by His stripes, we are healed. Right? So sometimes it's easy for us to share it to the people, maybe suffering from colds, headaches, right? But sometimes when we are faced with people suffering for quite a long time, and maybe in the terminal illness, and God wants us to tell that my plan for that person is to heal him or is to heal her. So sometimes our response is that, God, will they really believe me if I would say that they've been in this condition for quite a long time? Right? So another thing is that another example is that because I was watching a news and I saw what happened to Thailand, the bombing, and I think if I remember it correctly, there's a Malaysian there just having their vacation, and because of that blast, four of their family members died. So we know that God's plan for each and every one of us is to prosper us and not to harm us, right? But when we are faced with those kinds of people, and God wants us to tell them, no, God's plan for you is to prosper you, not to harm you. Sometimes, because of what they are experiencing, maybe, or our response might be, God, will they really believe me? Or will they really believe what I'm saying? Right? So the reason why sometimes we think of that is because we feel that we should, or it's our responsibility to say or to prove what we are saying is true. Sometimes we feel that the burden to prove is on us, right? But actually, we don't need to prove anything because it is unto God to prove. It is unto God to prove. So first, let me explain this because I really want to be careful with this. It is unto God to prove. What I mean by this is this. When I said it's unto God to prove, I'm not saying that God is obliged to prove himself to us as if he owes it to us. No, what I'm saying is that God is so powerful, God is so almighty, he can do anything. But in his sovereignty, it is his decision to show himself to the people, or how he would show himself to the people. It is his decision. Okay, if God wants to kill that person, then God will do it, because God is sovereign. So remember that it is not, it is unto God to prove. So in this that time, this God's response. Then the Lord said to him, "What is it? What is it that in your hand?" He said, "A staff." He said, "Throw it on the ground." So he threw it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses ran from him. So a staff became a serpent. Second. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 6, again the Lord said to him, "Put your hand inside your cloak." And he put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out, behold, his hands was leprous like snow. So here, God showed himself to the people by demonstrating his power. So he turned a staff into a serpent, and he caused Moses' hand to be leprous at the same time healing him. So he chose to demonstrate his himself, or to reveal himself by demonstrating his power. So once again, I want to remind you that it is unto God to prove. In his sovereignty, it is unto him. It's not unto us. It's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is just to, because it is unto God to prove, but it is unto us to obey. All we need to do is just to obey. And let's just leave it to God, if God will show himself. It is his decision. So, third is, Moses' third response to God is this. In Exodus chapter 4, verse 10, "But Moses said to the Lord, 'Oh my Lord, I am not eloquent, either in the past or since you have spoken to your servant, but I am slow to speech and dumb.'" So Moses responded by saying, "I am not eloquent, I am slow of speech and of dumb." So here Moses was saying that I am neither fluent nor persuasive. Or if I have the words to say, I don't know how to say it. So that is what Moses said to God, his third response. So they said that maybe what Moses experienced is caused by something, a first-time speaker experience. Okay, so sometimes maybe, because it is his first time, so he was a little bit rattled, or so a little bit nervous. They said that maybe that is what Moses was experiencing. So second, they said that maybe Moses really had a physical defect that prevented him to be fluent in speaking. So third is that because Moses had already been in the wilderness for 40 years, so maybe lack of experience of him, because he's been in that field or in the wilderness for quite a long time. So those are the reasons why Moses responded that way. So for me, I just want to share some of my experiences regarding this, because I think with among the three responses of Moses, this is something that I can really relate to. Okay, I remember when I was still in Manila. So every first Sunday of the month, they will ask us to, they will ask every missionary to go in front of the stage to serve as an MC. Okay. So our goal or our task as an MC is like what we are doing here. So our task is to transition people from, to welcome people and then to transition them from worship to the word, give some announcements, and share, exhort people to the rest of the tithes and offering. So actually the task is quite simple. But being in a crowd of around 700 people, so you just know that if you miss out or if you fail in terms of the transition, then it will really have a major effect or impact in the whole worship service. So just imagine the pressure. I remember sometimes we will just do. It will be an MC for two to three services, and every time it's just 5 to 10 minutes. But we remember that when we go home, we really feel drained, because not because of the task that we need to do, but because of the pressure of the people. So I just remember that after. During the worship time, I still remember that sometimes the worship would go up to this level. But after transitioning, the crowd you just feel that the level, the intensity become this low. So from this one to this one. So I remember that is during my first time, or when I was just starting to serve as an MC in the church. And I also remember the time that, because sometimes we go to different churches and then train them to go to different nations for 10 days for a short-term mission trip. And I remember that sometimes I would just go home discouraged, and sometimes I'm asking myself, God, is this really what you want for me? Is this what you really have for me? So, but I'm so thankful with the people who continually encourage me to just continue hold on to God's calling and God's purpose for me. And I'm also thankful for my wife for always encouraging me. But she knows that most of the time, before I just go home so discouraged and really wanting to give up already. But things started to change when I realized that, by the way, Moses responded that way because he was focusing on his proficiency. So he was focusing on his language proficiency. So, I remember things started to change when I realized that it is not about my words, but it is about God's message. So, here in Exodus chapter 4, verse 11 to 12, then the Lord said to him, "Who has made man's mouth? Who makes him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with you, and I will be your mouth and teach you what you shall speak." So God said to Moses, "Who has made man's mouth?" And he said, I will be with your mouth and teach you what you shall speak." So, it's not about our words, it's about God's It's about God's message. So, just imagine, it is about God's message. So, God said to Moses, isn't I was the one who created your mouth? So if I have created your mouth, will I not put words in it as well? So it's the same thing with us. Maybe it's also we are also having difficulty sharing the word to other people. But remember this, that God was the one who created our mouth. So God is also the one who will put these words in our mouth. So another story is that as a missionary, one of the challenges that we face is the challenge of having the language barrier. So our 10 days team is not here, but I believe that they also experience the same thing. Sharing the gospel to the people, but people are not being able to understand what they are saying. Sometimes you share your testimony, but you don't know if you don't know if it is registering in their minds or not, right? But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because it's not about our words. It's about God's. It's about God's message. So I'm sure that God will be the one to give us the wisdom on how to share the word to the people. And if not, God will send another person to help us communicate what God wants to say. Because again, it's not about our words, it's about God's message. God's message is so important that He will really find ways to make a way for His message to be conveyed. So again, it's not about our words. It's about His message. So just a recap, it's not about us, it's about God. It's not unto us to prove. It's unto God to prove, it's unto us to obey. It's not about our words, it's about His message. So before I continue, we saw how amazing, how powerful Moses' encounter with God was. Then second, we saw the response, or how Moses responded towards God. And now let's look at why Moses responded that way. So I believe the reasons why Moses responded that way is because first, he failed to realize that he was saved for that. So I don't have enough time to really look at Exodus chapter 1, but if we really look into it, if you remember that, that was the time that the Israelites was increasing in numbers, and the Egyptians was being threatened by them. So what they did is that they oppressed them by giving them hard labor. So they oppressed them by giving them works, hard works. Right? And not only that, the Pharaoh commanded for the child, firstborn male child to be killed, right? So, but with God's sovereignty, Moses was saved. Right? And then second is that he failed to realize that he was equipped and trained for it. Okay, so remember that the Pharaoh's daughter got Moses, and she allowed Moses to live in the courts of the Egyptians. Right? Actually, Moses lived as a prince, right, of Egypt. That's why there's a movie, Prince of Egypt. So he was actually trained and equipped in the ways of the Egyptians, but he failed to realize that. So third, there was already a burden that is being placed in his heart during that time. remember he saw the Israelites being hurt by the Egyptians. That's why he responded by rescuing that that Israelite. That's why he killed the Egyptians. When we look at that, we can see that there is already a burden, a passion in his heart that is already increasing. God is already wounding his heart. God is already creating a passion in his heart. Right? So, and last is he failed to realize that his character was being molded by God during the time, during the 40 years of his time in the wilderness. I believe that God was already molding him for this task. Right? So, I believe that it's also the same thing with us, right? And it is in the time of isolation, lowest point of our lives, that our character is molded. Right? So Moses responded that way because he failed to realize that he was safe, he was equipped and trained. A burden is being placed in his heart. His character was molded for this task. And as I end, so we saw Moses, we saw how Moses responded and why, right? But the good thing here is this: even though Moses has a lot of hesitation, has a lot of question in his mind, at the end of Exodus chapter 4, he chose to obey God. He chose to obey God. So, because he chose to obey God, he was able to experience God in a mightier way. He was able to experience God in a mightier way. And not only that, he became an instrument to deliver a people and to lead a nation. So because Moses obeyed, he became God's instrument. He saw God's hand in a mightier way. And he was able to lead a people out of slavery. And he was also able to lead a nation. So second is, even though Moses has a lot of hesitations, God stick with him. God stick with him. So why? Because that task is specifically assigned for him. Right? God can choose other people, but God stick with him because that task is specifically assigned to Moses. So it's also the same thing with us. That there is a task, there is a people, a city or a nation, a country that is specifically assigned for you, or assigned to you. There are people that is specifically assigned to you that only you can reach out. That we cannot reach out is only you. Because that task, that person, that city, that office, that campus is specifically assigned for you. And in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it says here, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before him, that we should walk in them." So it says here, "For good works, which God prepared before him." So there is a good works that is specifically prepared for you. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." There is a race that is specifically set for you, that only you can run. So So like what I said, there is a, like what the scripture said, there is a specific works that is assigned for you. There's a specific race that we need to run. So it is only you that that you can, who can fulfill that task. Okay, so maybe like Moses, you also have some hesitations. You also have some questions in your mind. If you can you do this or can you do that? But I hope that like him, like Moses as well, we will choose to obey what God's telling us to do. Okay? Because obedience is the road to encounter. Obedience is the road to encounter. So that is what I want to share to you today. So can we just take this time to just pray to God? God, we just want to thank you, God, for this time. Thank you, Lord, for the word that you have given us for today. Lord, we just pray, God, that like a seed, God, it will be planted in our hearts. God, that it will take root. God, that it will grow. It will bear fruit. Fruit that will last. Lord, we just want to thank you, God. Thank you because you have prepared beforehand good works for us to do. God, thank you, God, because you have already set a specific race for us to run to. And I just want to take this time to pray for people. Maybe you are a person who's asking God, I want to have that encounter. Maybe you are that person asking God, I want to have that encounter. And I just want to pray for you that if you are that person, you are saying God, I want to have that. If you are that person, you can make sure that see that line. Thank you. And maybe you are a person that who have already encountered God, and you already know that this is what God wants you to do. You already know the task that God had given you. But you have some hesitations. Like Moses, you have a lot of questions in your mind. Maybe because of your position, maybe because of you're looking for a proof, or maybe you're looking at your proficiency in terms of how to do it or how to say it. If you are that person, I just want you to raise your hand. Lord, we just want to take this time to lift up God and our brothers and sisters. God, you see our hands, God, and more than the hands, God, you see our hearts. So, Father, I just pray for those people who are longing for that encounter. God, you said in your word that if you will seek me with all of your heart, then you will find me. God, I pray, God, that you will honor the desires of their hearts. God, that as they desire to encounter you, God, I just pray, God, that they will be experienced. God, I pray, God, that their minds, their hearts, their ears, their eyes will be open. God, to whatever things that you are showing them, or maybe the things that you have already shown them. Lord, I just pray, God, that people's heart God will just be discerning enough to hear you, to see the things that you are doing. In Jesus' name. And again, I also want to pray for those people that God, you already know, that they already know what they want, what you want them to do. But there are some hesitations because maybe they are just looking at their possessions. God, maybe they are looking for a proof, or maybe they are focusing on their proficiency. But God, we thank you, God, because it's not about us, God. It's about you. Thank you, God, because it's not about, it's not unto us, God, to prove. It's just unto us to be. God, we thank you, God, because it's not about our words, but it's about our message. It's about your message. And Lord, I just pray, God, that I pray, God, that I pray, God, for the grace for them to just obey whatever you want them to do. And I believe, God, that as they obey, God, they will see your hand. God, they will see your hand in their lives. They will see your hand in the lives of other people. How you change them, how you set them, set them free. God, as they obey, we thank you, God, that they will experience you more and more. And they will just be amazed with the things that you have done in them and through them. Lord, we just want to lift up this time to you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Snacks and welcome to join us in our fellowship. Right, God bless you.